Gustav Leonhardt was a man of impeccable taste. He always looked just perfectly appointed and well-dressed and groomed. And in many aspects of his life, it reflected that he had a musical elegance that he happily shared with students in many, many settings. Now, I'm going to turn this over to Jillon, who will expound on more on the musical dimensions. So, thank you.
Thanks, Elaine.
Yeah.
Thank you. My first memory of Gustav Leonhardt was through his amazing recordings in, I'd say the 1970s. And my first harpsichord teacher was actually a harpsichord builder, Keith Hill, because he was the only one in Grand Rapids, Michigan, where I grew up, who knew anything about playing the harpsichord. And so as a teenager, I took lessons with him. And he would, how many of you remember LP records, long play records? He would play them at that slow speed so that I could hear all of the articulations, the starts of notes and releases of notes that Gustav Leonhardt was doing in his music. And it was incredible. I was captivated by this playing, even though I didn't recognize at the time the importance of Gustav Leonhardt in the revival of early music on the historic harpsichord. Elaine mentioned his students being dispersed throughout the United States, and one of them was Lisa Crawford, who was teaching at Oberlin. So it seemed logical to go study with her, and I did that, was fortunate to do that. And then it seemed logical to go study with the man himself, with Gustav Leonhardt. So my experience musically in Amsterdam and studying with him was both inspiring and absolutely amazing. Gustav Leonhardt lived and breathed music of the 17th and 18th centuries. And he had an unprecedented understanding, at least unprecedented in our century, of how this music should be played. And it was not just in a theoretical, musicological way, although that was present too, but how it could best be expressed and felt and could speak to us and sing to us and move our emotions. Studying with him meant learning how to express the affects of the music. And this done on a relatively unexpressive, if you will, instrument, where no matter how hard you play the note, it doesn't get louder or softer appreciably. And in fact, I think it was Alan Curtis who relayed to Elaine that that Leonhardt had said one must put in 1,000% to get 3% back from the instrument. But that 3% was so precious. And so what we're going to talk about today is how to get that expression on the harpsichord via Gustav Leonhardt. First of all, the importance of timing. Alan Curtis also said that every note was placed with exactly the most appropriate split second timing when Leonhardt played. When you place the note and release it, that's more important on the harpsichord than on any other instrument because of its limited dynamics. We'll also talk today about musical gesture, whether it's two notes, ta-ta, or several notes or an entire phrase. We'll talk about articulation, one of our most expressive tools on the harpsichord, how you connect notes or don't connect them, and the many variations thereof. Rhythmic flexibility, we're going to be discussing, so that you have a large, steady beat, but within that, some rhythmic freedom. Arpeggiation, strumming the chord, the speed of the strumming, the direction of the arpeggiation, and there are thousands of ways of doing this. The touch, the suppleness of the hand, and the closeness of the hand to the keys so you have immediate control. How we release notes. We'll talk about the fringed release where you don't release all the notes at once because you'd hear a big click of the releases, but sort of peeling the hands off the harpsichord. And then finally, singing the lines. When I remember in lessons, Leonhardt would frequently sit down to play. He'd say, "Oh, may I?" and sit down to demonstrate, which, of course, who was going to say no? And that was really how he taught, was through the example of his playing in many ways. And as he was playing, I would notice his Adam's apple moving up and down because he was singing sort of in his throat, I think sort of humming. It was, the musical line was always going. So I feel that his music making, though informed by the sources, by studying the original music, etc., was really felt from within and then communicated through his amazingly controlled and elegant hands. And that was a great treat to be present to that. So I think we'll go ahead now and have our first student come up.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Catherine. That was a very lovely, thoughtful, reflective interpretation of a beautiful piece. So there were some things. I actually picked two pieces. I took a lot of notes. So what would that mean? After going there for an hour plus, I would go back to my my inn. There weren't exactly U.S.-style motels in Amsterdam then. And I would just write copious notes, just trying to understand, you know, what he was saying. And so I basically want to just share with you as much as I can of what, I didn't play it precisely like you did, but, you know, the notes can be helpful anyway. Mm-hmm. So he had a concept of good and bad chords. Mm-hmm. And the good chords were the ones on the strong beat. So in 4-4 time, you'd have 1 and 3. Mm-hmm. And the bad chords were the weaker pulses. So he talked about that a lot. He very much was focused on the bass line, and it should sound varied and have character and be really heard. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that I would, you know, if he told me that, I think he might have had a similar something there. Mm-hmm. So, and then the variation of the arpeggiation was a really big deal, you know. Mm-hmm. So you tended to go into a certain type of arpeggiation, and you kept the Xerox copy or kept printing it. And so, you know, if you just would think a little bit more about where you want something and what's the difference with something that sounds firmer, you know, it mm-hmm. grabs your ear. Because if it's all sort of sweet, mm-hmm. Nothing's quite kind of having a certain bite to it. Mm-hmm. And particularly, he loved these sort of witty, he loved Frescobaldi. And I think I took these two pieces that you're playing to him on my first lesson, because I loved it too. And thought, well, might as well take it to what seemed like the finest interpreter I could imagine. And so anything that was conversational, bum, ba-da-dum, ba-da-dum, ba-da-dum. He loved that, kind of joyful. You get his eyes would start sparkling as he would think about how much fun he was having. So conversation, you have to have a sense of dum, ba-da-dum, 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 ba. And it keeps popping at different places, and you don't know where it's going to pop out next. And so there's a surprise element, which is nice to take advantage of. One of the really big things I wanted to talk to you about, and for me, was just, now I had studied with Alan Curtis, who had also studied with Leonhardt. So all of us who had studied with somebody who studied with Leonhardt weren't tremendously shocked by what Leonhardt said. Certainly if they had taken their lessons seriously, and Alan Curtis was clearly a person of that, and Lisa. So when you got to Leonhardt, you got a lot of reinforcement, probably some things you already had heard about, but some new and more subtle ways to do it. And he's somebody who could spend, like, you know, 15 minutes on one bar trying to explain the way through. And there is a wonderful interview of him, and he goes through, there's no student, but he goes through an allemand from a French suite. And it's a Dutch person, so you have English subtitles. But it's the closest experience to a lesson that I've seen on any of the videos whatsoever. And that would be highly recommended. So what was the thing that popped out at me, particularly on the second page, was you had some opportunities to do, oh, right. No wonder. Okay, so you had some opportunities, especially in the 16th mm-hmm. notes, to do little gestures. And he was all about these little tiny gestures that would build up and make such a huge difference. So, you know, this kind of, you're constantly sort of kind of tugging at the music to kind of, come on, get closer, speak to me. So da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know, he loved that sort of thing. And if I didn't articulate. It wasn't just notes that were conjunct, but sometimes a third apart or whatever. And he would be very clear that you want to articulate, you know, like if there's a three-note gesture going in one direction, that you want to have an articulation before and have a sense of one thought, you know. So each gesture is a little thought, mm-hmm. and then you build them all up. So I don't know if you want to, he never let you try something. You know, he would just tell you, figure either you're going to get it or not, and that the rest of it was up to you. But so you go home and you start trying to figure out, well, let me try to figure out what he was saying. Okay. So, and you never brought it back. So there you were. But if you look at the third page and the, second page, sorry. It's this part. Okay. Da, 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 da. Yeah. And you can start sort of slow. Bum, okay. Ba, dum, ba, dum, ba, da, 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 and kind of build it up a little bit. Good. So this, that's okay. Good. And so this one could also have a. Bum, ba, da, da. Right, that's right.
Okay.
Yeah, so why don't you take it just from the downbeat of that bar, or the chord that's right there that goes in. Yeah, don't get too weighted down. Da 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 da. It's try to get to your destination as well. Nice. So that's the kind of thing that would start to make the music sparkle quite a bit. And the sparkling was always fun. And he, one of the ways he got sparkle, and I also took some Froberger music to him, was he would have a run, and the run would kind of go over two octaves or so. And as you went up, it would become more and more articulated as you go up. Da, 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 da. It was like a string of pearls, but they were moving faster, heading to their destination. And all that individual articulation just created, it's like the music just was vibrating with life with that. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, good, 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 good. So you're listening a lot to what you're doing, which is really nice. So intro that Frescobaldi wrote, he talks about how when you get to the end of a line, you can slow it down. And also what Leonhardt added, for example, in the right here, to actually do a lot of articulate. So you really get, if you just kind of play, it doesn't have quite as much direction. I think that's probably the concept direction that would maybe to think about a little bit, kind of building momentum to get to a certain place. And I feel like with the harpsichord, if you do this much, it only speaks that much. But if you do this much, you get maybe, it's going back to what Alan Curtis said. Yeah. So I think, you know, that's something I always think about. How much can I do here without going over the limits of, appropriate discretion and musical reflection. So one thing he did talk about in the part in three on the first page is that this was two different figures. So you have the chromatic one going on the top line, and then underneath it, which is slow, it's very slow. This is the third line down of the beginning of the piece, the second bar in three, and that the other was very lively. And you have to hold both those thoughts, played not too fast, although yours I thought was a little slow, so as to also reflect the mood of the chromaticism. So you have to kind of have a bounce in your lower part, and then, at least in the first bar, it's the lower part, and then kind of a longer thought. And with chromaticisms, tend to have a lot of overlegato, because he loved dissonance. Absolutely loved, and he talked a lot about, well, this is, hold the dissonance, don't rush on. We want to hear that. So that's something that I think could be very useful. And he also was very conscious of when something was the last time the figure would, it's sort of a little bit of nostalgia. After playing with the figures for 10 or 12 times, then you get the last one, they're leaving us, you know. And then the bass line right here with all the 16ths kind of just emerges out of the bass. It's just really beautiful. It goes all the way up, the 16th starting on the G, and it goes all the way up to E. And that's a nice long run. So you want to feel that sweep moving all the way in. Okay, so this is a typical Leonhardt kind of fun comment. So you get down to this, why don't you just play from here? And the second bar, he said, it's a conversation. Play animatedly, but not everyone has something so important to say. He was very had a sense of taste, and you know who was just babbling on, and who had, he was a man of not he was not very loquacious, but he got inspired enough. I have a lot of notes on this one, which was I'm grateful for. But anyway, try that. Yeah, yeah. So this dissonance he really liked a lot. See if you can hold that just a tad more. Try that one more time. Goes into the seventh. He liked the thing where the notes were being held over and the note would pop in that would create a seventh. That happens so frequently. Okay. So just in general. Okay, good. Good, good. Does that feel a little more interesting to you? I mean, you also have to make sure you're interested in your playing. Okay, so here's another point he would make. So you have here an F sharp going to an F natural. So this is the third bar of the second page. And then you have a rest. And he said it's like a bell ringer that it tells us that something is happening. So you release the F natural very quickly. Sound it to yourself. Now that's an instruction, some set of instructions from a teacher. So how are we doing on time, Jillon?
You've got a couple more minutes.
Oh, great. Okay. So here's an example where he wanted something to sound very brilliant. So the third line down of the second page, and it's not meant to suddenly double in time. It's meant as an accelerando. So if you're too precise with the rhythm, that's not where we want to go. Try articulate every. Yeah, that's it. Da, 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 dum. Release the A at the end of that run. Ba, 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 ba. Yeah, good, good, good. That already gets something a little more lively. Yeah, so, and another thing is you have a romance going with arpeggiated chords. And sometimes it might be nice to do some things mm-hmm. that are firm. So if you're kind of going with a certain energy in the music and momentum that's kind of building, mm-hmm. you need that firmness to kind of, mm-hmm. Give it kind of a punctuation.
Yeah.
And it is like a punctuation. So if it's all nice commas, a few hyphens, you know, but no exclamation marks. So you could try to do the 6-4 here, mm-hmm. and there was a firm, this is the bottom of the second page, yeah. Yeah, you could start anywhere you want, but this is the one, da da da, especially have da 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 rum, and then it kind of sends you off into the next. And he says, take a little more time for the details of articulation. That's what he's telling me. Okay. That was a nice dissonance. But you, okay, so now you have a nice firm chord, but you don't have the momentum that makes it coherent as a firm chord.
Right.
So you have to get a little more movement to get to that place and like, wham!
Okay.
That's better. That's getting there, growing. So another thing is... Okay, fine. Just this will probably come up a little bit more. Is that he certainly didn't talk about it this way, but sometimes when you want to hold something very, very intense and dissonant and juicy, it's almost like you hold it till you absolutely, it makes no sense to hold it anymore, but you hold it that long. It's like you're on a cliff and you're kind of looking over, woo! And when you feel like you're about to fall, that's when it's time to step back, get solid, and move on. But you kind of just take it to its limit of what you can do. So that was lovely. And the firm at the end, let's just roll maybe the last three bars, and then we'll just do firm at the end. Good job. Thank you. You gave it a good college try. Good. Thank you very much.
There were a couple of things that I wanted to just comment on quickly, because there were things I had mentioned when I was talking at the beginning that I thought you did so well. One was that your larger beat, in sections where the beat needed to be steady, your larger beat was steady, but there was this incredible amount of just expressive nuance within the smaller notes, which was lovely. And also, as the introduction to these toccatas says, as Frescobaldi says, these are extremely sectional. And I believe he says that you can end the piece at any time if you were playing this for a church service and they have the communion ready and we're waiting. You could stop any time at any cadence. But when you went on after each of those stop places, it was very clear, because of the way you articulated, what your intent was and exactly where we were in the music. There wasn't any question is this in 3 or 4? So I appreciated that so much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, sure. So now we have Max, I believe.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. There are so many things I liked that you did so beautifully. Certain arpeggiations, such as in the third bar, that little tierce de coulée filling in slide was just, I love the, first of all, your touch was lovely, and that just sang and was so just so tender. I really appreciated that. And the bass line in the next line, the second bar of the second line, there was a lot of your timing was beautiful. And I think the question of timing and rubato and that sort of thing is a question we all sort of are constantly pushing against. I think there, at Leonhardt talked about always respecting what the composer had put on the page, and going first with that, and then fudging it a bit if you wanted to, but still making sure we were faithful to what the composer wrote on the page. I found there were a few times when you stopped on a note, I believe on page 2, the third line, the third measure. Can you just play from the bar before that, where you've got the A in the bass? And play it as you did. Yeah, so the chord that has the D, mm-hmm. You actually turn that into sort of a half note. So I think here, this is a section where it's, one can imagine that this is the ringing of the bells at the morning of this passing, and the church bells. So it probably needs to be a little more even there. So, okay. Dum, dum, chi, dum, dum. And bells also don't ever stop ringing. I mean, you don't have a damper on them the way we have on the harpsichord. So see if you could play that passage and actually let everything ring as much as possible. Okay. And you might even try a little arpeggiation, even if you've only got two notes. Mm-hmm. On the downbeat, say, arpeggiate. The bells maybe are kind of coming a little before and after each other. So start in that same place, okay. The second bar of the third line of page 2. I think if one adds a little bit more arpeggiation to that, so that it sounds a little more lost, which one might feel lost in this situation. Careful in the previous bar, so this is the third line of page 2, the second bar, that you pay attention to what his rhythm is. It's a... Oops, that note didn't play. So it's almost like a chord and then a slide. So from the bar before that, the first... begin. Mm-hmm. Now he does write plus vite, mm-hmm. And if you notice at the bottom of the page, the first page, the last bar, let's talk about that a moment. What does plus vite mean?
I don't know the exact translation, but I know it's similar to più mosso, mm-hmm. More motion.
Yeah, more motion, a little faster. So start the second half, and as you... this gives an opportunity to practice something else, which occurs at the very beginning. There were some places where you did a lovely job of just letting the the sound blossom. I just got the sense you were listening to the harpsichord. But I think you could do that more at the beginning and at the beginning of the second half. Keep in mind that these notes again have a gesture. Ta 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 ta, or ta 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 wa, which Leonhardt was known to say, or not even ta ta ta, but do 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 do. You know, they're not so important themselves, but the chord is. So I think that might be a place where you could either slur them together with a slur, an overheld slur. Which you can do on the harpsichord, not on the organ or piano so well, where you actually hold one note through the next and it doesn't sound so cacophonous. Or you could articulate the air. This is what, like Elaine was saying, let it hang there, and just before you feel like you're going to go up over the cliff, you go on. So just try that beginning, and then we'll just start the second half and get to the plus vite.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, lovely, lovely. And I also felt the sense of you feeling the half beat of the bar. Now try the second half, and let's focus on the same thing. And when you get to the plus vite, you could start a little bit gradually, but then try to keep... again, following the half bar pulse, keep the motion going for that entire section so that you stay at approximately at the same tempo, the same fast tempo. Okay, try from there. From remembering Mr. Blancpain. Great, okay. So there were a couple of moments where I could really sense you actually feeling and really listening to the blossom of the harpsichord sound before you went on. That was excellent. Elaine is signaling me that we need to go on to because we have another Louis Couperin piece. You might go through on your own and just check out rhythms. Sometimes he'll do pickups that are eighth notes, three pickups that are eighths instead. And I think that's an expressive, for example, of the first page, the end of the third line. Those are eighths instead of sixteenths. So that conveys a slightly slower gesture, a more pensive sort of way of expressing those three notes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very lovely. Okay. And now Lorenzo. Louis Couperin published the pieces, well, there are two manuscripts, actually, and he didn't put pieces into suites, per se, so we're free to choose a piece from one suite, an F, and another piece from another suite. And so this is the F major, one of the many, I believe, three F major chaconnes. So go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, so this, I think this piece, well, what is your concept of like, what do you imagine as you're playing this piece, or what's your concept of the character of it?
The piece, I think, shows different characters, and it's very tender at the beginning, and it gets a little spicier, I think, in the imitative part, especially the second couplet. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. yes, I think it combines also the tenderness and the spicy aspect, also mm-hmm. in the third couplet, and mm-hmm. it gets tender again toward the end. Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes, there's that wonderful low harmony that's mm-hmm. just so expressive. Yeah, yeah. Well, that's true. And with these chaconnes, where you have a repeated, I guess you could call it the rondo or the mm-hmm. refrain, that continues to come back after each of the verses or the couplets. The rondo can be played slightly differently each time, perhaps mm-hmm. reflective of what you just played in one of the couplets. And the couplets can also have different characters. And, you know, you might play one of them, the more tender ones, up on the upper manual. It's really, that's totally up to you. I think the one of the things to really capture is that chaconne feel in the initial statement, and that means sort of sweeping through from bar to bar. Da di da di da 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 da. Chum chum pa pam. So you have two strong beats in the third bar, and also just letting this hang there a little bit. Let me just, if you don't mind.
Of course not.
May I is what Leonhardt used to say. Oh, may I? Yes, thank you. and if this is in fact tender, then you might explore a little more overheld articulation. Second chord in the second bar. First of all, if the ties weren't there, this is the harmony we'd have on that dummy. It's just gorgeous. And then it finally resolves. Ah, and then cadence. So I think you can let it linger there, and also by just moving through the notes of the harmony that's on the second in the second bar. It makes it sound more like, oh, I'm just arpeggiating mm-hmm. a chord. It happens to be written out in eighth notes, but I'm just arpeggiating a chord here. And then you go on with a little more strike. And I think every time the refrain comes back, because it is initially repeated, sometimes we don't take repeats a second time, but I think in this case it needs it to make it an eight bar phrase. So try the beginning a little bit. Yeah, much better. Really, really very sweet. Lovely. And when you, after you've come off the second chord, you could do what we talked about in terms of, Leonhardt used to talk about peeling the hands off of the keyboard. So in slow motion, I let go of my thumbs first, and then what you're left with is the bass and the melody to sound last. But you can actually have a clear break before you go on. Of course, you don't want to take too many beats in that bar, but try it one more time. Nice. And let me see. So when I remember one thing that stuck with me with Gustav Leonhardt, with what he said about French music, because I liked to play, especially the 18th century Dufflis and Balbatra, with lots of energy and play it sort of Italian it because it seemed to ask for it. But he made a comment that he said the French, I can't do it with his Dutch accent, but the French always hid their cards up their sleeve. they weren't going to give away the full picture. And so it was a little, the French were more subdued, a little more elegant. So when you get, it struck me that he might have said something about this. Yeah. If you're a little too rambunctious there, it loses the elegance. So you might consider doing a little paired articulation there. Or you could do it separately, but then you need to be very light in the hand so that you're heading towards the next bar. Just try that side. This is the third line, end of the third line.
Okay.
Yeah. The first of the four eighths. Has to have a little more length so that they're a little more, a little more inegal, a little more unequal in rhythm. Try a little bit more, a little more time on that C. The bass line is holding, so you've got some freedom there. Now try it with really pairing them articulation wise. So in order to disguise, since the E and the D are not so important, they're just passing notes, you can hold down the F through them and then re-articulate. Just try that really slowly. Yeah, that's the idea. And let's see, what else? Yeah, and when you want to get, especially when you want to be tender, again, let me sit down. And, I can keep that on in case we need to. For example, if you, that one that you just played is very fiery and positive, but the next one could be sweeter. The ones that, my point being that the ones that you want to have be more sweet and tender, try to use a little bit more arpeggiation. Two notes. You can do a slight arpeggiation to make them more tender. The ones that you want to be more fiery, then, then that could be a little more, a little less arpeggiated. Yes, are we need to move on? Okay, and I think we're going to take a quick, thank you, though. That was lovely.
Dupree.
The reason I picked this piece was for me very special. I had taken, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 lessons with Leonhardt, and I thought they'd gone, not bad. I was learning a lot. And I played this, and all he did was stop me everywhere and say, you're not hearing the dissonance, you're not holding, you're not placing your chords, you're not listening. Whack, whack, whack. And I mean, I went home sort of in some level musically trembling, and I couldn't play a whole bar at that point to save my life, because I kept starting to see all the things I was missing. And I said, wow, there's that there, and whoa. So I worked really hard. Finally, after I had to go back for another lesson a week later, and I finally was able to play again with some fluidity. And he heard the difference. I thought, score, that was nice. And I really appreciated what he did. It changed the way I played forever. And a lot of it, it's not just listening to the dissonance, but it's also getting a feeling for the bass and how the bass can add life to the music. So maybe some of you don't know that the courant was Louis XIV's favorite dance movement, and he took a lesson. I think this is Alan, who told me this, Alan Curtis. Every day he had a lesson on the courant, probably as good exercise. And so going to exercise classes, dance master came over. And he just loved it. And part of why I think he loved it, let's see, can you imagine, you love courants too, right?
Yeah.
So
she dances them all the time.
Of course. So what do you love about the courant?
I think it's like a slightly faster dance than the allemande, which is like just like really grand and pompous with like couples like walking down. Like,
and which had actually come out of the pavane. Mm-hmm. So that's part of the Renaissance audience. And William Byrd was still writing
pavanes. He wasn't writing allemandes. Yeah. So you find with the courant, what's different for you that inspires you when you play it?
I think it's like a little like more like lively.
It's lively.
Yeah.
Yeah, and do you have a sense of what makes it lively? Hard to say, huh?
I think maybe the bass lines are, I like the bass lines.
You like the bass lines a lot. Yeah. Well, I think some of what also really brings it to life is that it keeps shifting rhythmically, and you're just constantly sort of caught off guard a bit, and then you, oh yeah, well of course, you know, and it has a fun quality to it. So some of the courant bars are in 2 and some are in 3, and then you often have hemiola bars. Let's see if I didn't pop those right away, but so the opening is kind of like the curtain opens. Here I've got a bunch of, he didn't say that, but you know, to me it's like you play that chord and the piece hasn't really started yet. Where it starts is on the C in the second half of the bar. Yeah? So you want to help us hear that quarter to a dotted quarter, because that's a frequent pattern of the courants. Virtually every bar has that, yeah? And the end of the second bar. So see if you can just put your ear a little bit more to the bass and also a little bit more to where you might be hearing some dissonance held over.
Piece starts out with a broken chord like it does, even though there's a solid chord, but it's still got some stile lute, is another term for that, where the chord is spread out, is that you want to let that sit for a moment before you move on and start the piece. So just try that opening bar. So just hear the A minor kind of warming up the sound and then move. You can't play back to tempo. You're listening, you're hearing so much, you see? And then if you spend a week doing that, it all settles back down. Yeah. So that's something, yeah.
And then it's, if you want, I would keep it more with that kind of bright up quality. So try it one more time. Yeah, okay, good. So, by the way, let's look at the beginning of bar five. That's the second line, the first bar. Do you know what he's doing there? It's basically that, but that's very often how it's written. Do you know what that's called? It's got a special term in French. No, it's a tierce coulée, and you'll see Bach writing them out. You'll see them scattered, and they're hiding sometimes in sort of long passages, but it's, I tend to play them the same when I see them in Bach, because he was very familiar with French music from the time he spent in Limburg on the border with France. So and you'll see them throughout. And the other thing is, when you have a lot of times just in there, that second bar, you're having, I would tend to put the appoggiatura before the on a weak beat. Strong beats, no. I would have them on the beat, but I would have them before. So let's try again, and let's see if we can't get a little more leverage of a, you know, what I would do is just put a little fermata on the middle of the first bar, just to tell myself, or I'd have some kind of a line like the curtain opener line, yeah, that we're gonna move on, but not until you let the A minor settle. So let's just do it again. It's getting better. So when you have an appoggiatura, which they use cymbals here, this is a weak beat right here, because this bar looks to be in three, the second bar. So I would make it strong, weak. So dum dum ba dum instead of da dum ba dum. So another thing I would consider doing here is just play the top voice here in the right hand. So when you have pickups, dum, 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 then we have, it's a way of doing a cadence, the tierce coulée. So let's try again, okay? Over.
Just a thought about the tierce coulée. I've had the honor and pleasure of working with a lot of singers who prefer to sing a lot of French baroque music. And it's often a very weak syllable, that second part of the tierce de coulée, and it's a short syllable. So if you think of, and it just poof, you come off that second little.
So you head out and then you pull back.
That helps if you can imagine a French word that ends in a weak syllable, that has two syllables.
So let's see if we can do that one more time. Maybe go through the first half and just try to start listening for where you can kind of hold the moment a little bit. Like this would be one place that you could. It's not that so dissonant. And then get the bass lively. Anytime you have quarters in the bass and courants, the first choice for my money is always to detach them, unless there's a really good reason not to, because it's part of what helps to keep the music. You know, I have this feeling of the music kind of just being lifted up into the air all the time instead of falling sort of soggily on the ground, but you're lifting it so it's off the page. Okay, try. Let's get that one. Lots of things got better. I think One thing you might spend some time really thinking about are how the eighths work to pick up the music to the next beat. You have eighth notes that these are standalone. Sometimes the eighth, if you just pluck it out of a set of eighths, you'll hear that it actually is an upbeat. It's not just part of the string. And here you have lots of eighths that are popping out that you can just bum, 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 bum. So just try to play that right hand from here a little bit and just think about the eighths as being bum, bum. Dum, ba, ba, dum. So this would be an articulation after that C. Yeah, that's already a lot better. Yeah, why don't you put the bass line back in and see how that feels. Yeah, and how about this one also? Dum, again, this is what's sticking out. It's almost invariably written with a trill, and the third is filled dropping, as Jillon had mentioned with singers. But that was a lot better. It's, you know, we came through the hard school of articulation. I don't know if that's still happening as much today, but I know that Leonhardt was very precise in where he thought articulation should be, because You want to give space for the note that matters, either because it's harmonically interesting or it's affecting a certain emotion or something, to have its moment to be heard. And if it's covered over by the prior note, you don't get as much flexibility of emotional intent. So articulation was kind of half the story of how to turn the harpsichord into an expressive instrument. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Beautiful.
so much in control in terms of being on the surface of the key and not a lot of extraneous movement. One of the first things I noticed when I first heard and saw Gustav Leonhardt play live was how he barely moved his arms and his hands. Have any of you heard him and seen him? Well, he's deceased now, of course, but did any of you hear him play live or see him play? It was just this amazing control and grace. And he once said to me, because I tend to move a lot when I play, he said, you know, you must think of yourself as, it's like there's a marionette show. And you're not actually one of the marionettes. You're the puppeteer controlling in a very calm way the action of the marionettes. So your fingers are the marionettes. But to be somewhat removed from the actual physical engagement of playing. And it really does help on the harpsichord because, as many of you who have played the harpsichord know, it's so easy for a note to go off when you're least expecting it, just by you coming at a chord maybe from a little too high or a little too assertively. So I really, I love that you're very in control and calm. And I also like the tempo you've chosen for this. How would you describe what this piece is about in terms of the character of it, the mood, the affect? What would you say?
In general, I see it's pretty celebratory or triumphant.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so. I think it's like, wee, joy. Yep. Yeah, and he gets that in a couple of ways. First of all, by these gestures. You have all these swirling things, particularly the sequences of rolling 16ths, such as the third line. In this edition, it's the third line, the second bar, where there's a high E on top. And all these gestures. And he also has these wonderful bouncing disjunct eighth notes. Just play the first bar so we can hear those eighth notes at the end of the first bar. Or right, you can arrive on the second bar, since that's where it goes. Yeah. So I think I remember now that we're doing this, I remember I played a gigue for Leonhardt once, and he said, this is a gigue. It must be sparkly and dancey, and the eighth notes, in that case it was the rhythm tum ta tum tum ta tum, can be more articulated. So I think if you approach this in terms of these. I can't do it. Let me sit down just a sec. So that they're really, really full of energy. And then you arrive. And then, so that you're, after you play that downbeat, your next strong beat isn't until, your next really strong beat, there's a little bit in the middle of the bar, but isn't until that next downbeat. And so if you put any D up, up, B up, up, bum, it's going to make those notes all sound a little too important. Okay. So try that again. Just play a couple lines worth. Play a couple lines. It's almost like popcorn popping or something. And it can be tricky because you want to stay right on the surface of the key and have both a quick attack and a quick release, but without bouncing off of the key. Try it one more time. Yeah, that's getting better as you go up the scale. Yeah, so that's something to work on. And also, this first is really powerful. He doesn't start. He does start quite a few pieces with an octave, but in this context of it being a 12-8 piece and then all these faster notes, it's really a dramatic statement. So be careful you don't start the 16ths too early. Let that have its own significance. Just try the first couple of bars again. Yeah. So if we think of that as being the strongest beat, that really tells us definitely where the downbeat is, and then all the notes come out of that. So I think you can probably even hold it a little bit longer. Now, in these swirling passages, there were times when you had some really nice
flexibility. And I think you can even be a little bit more flexible. We were talking about having the, you know, the overall bigger pulse being fairly strict, but having the smaller notes, and especially the smallest notes being 16th notes, having them be a little more flexible. And so let me just show what I mean. It's easier than... So I'm going to start at the beginning of the second line. So just crunching that together a little bit more. It's almost a little bit of a roll of the hand. And then etc. So just play with that a little bit. Maybe that's a good place to start, somewhere in there. Second line, beginning of the second line. Yes, exactly. So you're bringing, in a way, you're bringing each group of the 16th notes just a tad late, you know, so that you can then let them be a gesture going forward. Now, there's an interesting point. If you notice, the second bar in this piece has these eighth notes. And there's always a discussion going on about whether those should be played as strict eighths. Dum, ti, um, ti, um, dum. Okay, we need to probably go on to the fugue in a minute. Is that what you're saying? Okay. Because it's in 12-8, there's a lot of evidence that suggests that they would be played like a triplet. Which does keep it in that, and it also makes this bar where you've got it against running 16ths. I don't know whether makes that make more sense. Dum bum 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 bum.
Sure.
So you might consider that. Also, I think you could consider in a place like that using a little softer. Oh, we're going to be sweet for a moment. You know, how nice. And there are other places within it too. I wanted to get to some of these sections where on the second page, where you've got so much motion bar. Oh, starting probably around 35. You've got all that intense thunderstorm eventually you end up with a long trail. And I think there can also be flexibility in that. And which you did when you got to the trill. And then oh, we're back to the sun has come out again. Yay. So I encourage you to just play with both flexibility of articulation and rhythm in this. I think it's such a fun piece. You might as well have even more fun with
yes.
it. Okay, let's go on to the fugue. Thank you. Yeah. Well, bravo, because this is one of the hardest fugues in terms, I mean, all Bach's fugues are challenging, but this one has four voices, and so it's often got the stretto of the theme, you know, coming in first in one voice, then in another, and it's really a challenge to keep each voice having its own individual character throughout. So when one starts learning a Bach fugue, you think about, well, how do I want the theme to be articulated? For example, this is a repeated note, a syncopation, and then a connected line. Actually, it's a relatively short subject. But this repeated note is like a nagging little squirrel on trying to get the bird seed or something. I don't know, you know. So you might think of doing it a little more actively and then activate the syncopation by articulating it. And in the meantime, you've had the upper voice come in. But then, of course, the challenge is, what do you do when you get to a bar? Where's one of the stretto bars where they come in? Let me think. I think it is bar one. Well, one tricky place, or where it starts, is bar 20, end of bar 27. Can you just play from from bar 26?
Yes.
And I don't know what edition you have of this. Do you have bar numbers? Okay, good. Yes, good. So if one chooses to articulate dum, 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 and then you have a place like this where you have some of the smoother notes going on against it, you need to, it's a really, like this times 100, where you have to keep the smooth line smooth and the short notes still very staccato. But I think it really does make the character of this sound, I think this is somewhat like a mischievous child or something, this piece, it's kind of like, you know, you can almost, yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, Bach had children around him all the time, so why not? But think of some character, you know, as you're continuing to work on this, which I encourage you to do because it's such a wonderful piece, you know, think of some character, either a character from a play or someone you know or some situation, and each of these having its own separate voice. I remember Leonhardt talking about the importance of going to hear good choral singing, especially of Renaissance and Baroque music, because then you hear all the individual parts and how they come out and how the words articulate when we articulate, we're essentially putting consonants in, or not, or continuing a vowel. And if one compares that to choral music or vocal music, it really, really does help. So if you think of it in that way, each of these lines has a different text, each of these little themes. And I also encourage you to use flexibility of rhythm. Let me just sit down a minute. And even some arpeggiation, even if you hear it as a faster keys, which you needn't, but it is written in cut time, so you want to at least have a sense dum 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 ding bum ba dee da dum that the smaller notes, the eighth notes, are going somewhere. But there's no reason you can't. In fact, there's good reasons for using arpeggiation. For example, in the seventh bar, there's a wonderful sort of seventh chord. I'll start the bar before. There's no reason why you can't arpeggiate that. I added an extra note. Sorry. And even this. Maybe those are short, maybe not. Moment there, so you can slightly arpeggiate. Are we doing okay on time, or do we? No, thumbs down. Anyway, so explore different all the different options you have in terms of both articulation and speed of arpeggiation. Sometimes it might be a quick, snappy one like there. I call it one where you whip the chords. So there's so much fun in this. So, you know, explore that. But thank you very much.
Thank you. First of all, can we give these two wonderful teachers a round of applause?
Pleasure.
I feel like there was so much left unsaid.
Oh, yeah.
In the best of ways that, you know, there's so much subtlety and nuance and to playing the harpsichord. Mm-hmm. And it felt like for the past 2 hours, as if Leonhardt came alive in this room.
That means
really
a lot.
Appreciate,
thank you.
Your sharing and just the amazing playing of all the people who very bravely came up and played this treacherous instrument. Not this particular, the instrument in general. The harpsichord, of course. It is, it's like you're drawn to it, but it is a very hard taskmaster, isn't it?
In a way, yes. Yeah. I think that was what Gustav Leonhardt burst open, is that idea that the harpsichord was a clanging, sort of unexpressive instrument. And certainly under his hands, it became a very, very expressive instrument. Not that other players before him had not achieved that to some degree, but he really had such a natural affinity for the instrument and was willing to explore, especially in terms of the articulation, all the possibilities that could help the sound to blossom and to be a dynamic instrument.
Yeah, I'd love to hear more about that. I think you alluded to it throughout today's teaching about the importance of listening to both speech and singing, this articulation, the speaking using consonants. Mm-hmm. I was just, before I came to do a little bit of prep, reading the section in Conversations with Early Music, Bernard Sherman, where Leonhardt speaks, and about the subtlety of really capturing all these consonants and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us a little bit more about how maybe Leonhardt expanded your concept of articulation in your studying with him?
Mm-hmm. You want to address that?
As I said earlier, I had a very hard taskmaster about articulation with Alan Curtis. He didn't take any prisoners. I thought in retrospect that he is and was one of the most person who understood gesture in Baroque music to just the highest level. And I'm sure a lot of that was from his groundwork with Leonhardt. But I think you ask a good question. So he was, a lot of it I didn't understand, and I would, like 3 years later, I said, wait, what was that piece? And I'm going to look and see what his marks were. And suddenly they all became comprehensible, which always helps. But really to, like rhetoric, the harpsichord needs to have a rhetorical quality to it. And timing, of course, is critical. So when you want to give a nice chord splash, you give it space to be heard and to be experienced. But it's how much space. So the timing really is absolutely essential. So also that all the subtleties of articulation, some are very soft. One thing we didn't talk about was when we first met, I heard Jillon practicing over and over and over a pickup to a chord opening like it could have been the Allemande of the first suite of François Couperin. I mean, there it is, going to that beautiful G major chord. And really, it's that you play the eighth, and before you release it, you start the bass note in the left hand. So the eighth eventually does get released, but it's covered. So the articulation does not leave this just unmusical dead gap. Silence and gap. And that is just so, now that's not every composer, but you know, that was another thing. We got tailored instruction for the just the language, the musical language of the different countries. And mm-hmm. so for mm-hmm. French music, that was just so, to make it luscious, but still you feel the line and the shape of the line because of the timing of the articulation and the arpeggiation that softens, and, mm-hmm. or no arpeggiation, which heightens the moment. Mm-hmm. And to really, on some level, be inside the music and be right there with it, because it keeps speaking to you what it wants mm-hmm. if you get inside of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think another thing which you spoke to is that one never played the same thing twice. And so it was essentially you were giving sort of a mini recital for a lesson. It could be a half an hour of music or more. And so if you were playing a suite, I remember I played a Bach suite for him. I can't remember which one now, but it was, I played the Allemande, say, and then he said, well, go on. You know, he clearly wanted to hear the entire piece. But what that did is, it meant that I was exposed to his ideas about how to play an Allemande, how to play a Courant, how to play a Sarabande, how to play a Gigue within one lesson. So it was a lot to take in, but if one took notes and really thought about it afterwards and went immediately home to try out what he suggested, there was so much provided within just one lesson, and you could cover a lot of national styles, and a lot of different genres of pieces. So it was very intensive and very, I found myself wishing, I went when I was only 22 to study with him. And about 10 years later, I thought, you know, maybe I should have waited a little bit longer just so I could really comprehend mm-hmm. musically, was a mature enough thinker about music to really take it all in. But maybe everybody felt that way studying with him, that it was just a challenge to absorb, even though, as both Elaine and I had teachers who had studied with him. So, you know, that meant that we already were prepped for it in a way. Hmm. So, it was amazing.
I'd love to hear a little more about, both of you mentioned a bit about styles, national styles, and developing a palette, because Italian is a very different language than French, is a very different language than German. Music, talk about the tierce clef, kind of like a silence, or something, the weakening of the beat. So how, and of course, now on YouTube, there's several videos of, I believe, of people playing various Bach pieces in Leonhardt's house in public recital, which is very lovely, but kind of being immersed in the culture. How did, Elaine, I think you mentioned to me at some point, it's like, it would have been very different if it were in Fresno, Leonhardt in Fresno, as opposed to Leonhardt in Amsterdam. So tell us more about the overall experience, not just Leonhardt, but the wider picture of being exposed to, I think, probably a much higher level of early music mm-hmm. than there was available in the States at the time.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it goes hand in hand, and it's an excellent question or request. For Leonhardt was a tremendous collector, and he was there right after World War II. He had been hiding out in the country, so they didn't, you know, the Germans didn't capture him for their work factories. And he had a harpsichord there. So that's part of what got him going. And then he started playing ensemble. But he just had tremendous interest and love for porcelain, for silver. He had an amazing silver collection. And he was constantly buying from that early phase. So if you go online and look at, I think it was Sotheby's, or maybe there's another auction house, but they auctioned, I mean, it just goes on. So while we were there, we were, in a sense, the second wave. Tamara, I think you might have felt that too. Alan, Curtis, and Lisa, you know, were kind of the front runners. And they had heard his recordings. Alan had heard his recording with Alfred Deller, the countertenor, and got very interested and wanted to go learn more. He spent like a couple years with him. He had a lot of time then, so he'd take him to museums. And Alan was raised in a little, you know, farm village in Michigan, and this was not part of his upbringing.
Oh my goodness.
So he just soaked it all up. And it all started to integrate and make sense. And the way Leonhardt would gesture when he talked looked like, you know, the porcelain wings and, yeah.
I was told to move over, but keep
going. Oh, okay.
Yeah, and also his, because he collected so many things and lived in the famous Bartolotti house, early 17th century house on the Herrengracht, the gentleman's canal, you would walk, it was like walking back in time, it really was. And both in terms of the house itself and in terms of his collection of so many beautiful, beautiful things, and then the harpsichords, of course. And he really, you could tell he was happiest in that amazing setting that took him and back, and also was such a strong support for his love of 17th and 18th century music.
One thing we should mention, that he lived the original lifestyle in the sense that when you went to lessons there, and I started January 1, there was no heat in this huge house. And if you worried about cold hands having trouble playing, Tamara's laughing.
It was.
And then had to bike back. Yes.
Yeah, it was. I mean, the air was just like crystalline.
Crisp.
Yeah, it was just amazing.
Yeah, they probably had, I think they had, you know, fireplaces and heaters probably in each room, but no, certainly no central heating.
And not in the large room. We had our lessons.
Room, no.
And so he would, the other thing that we wanted, that we always talk about with humor, we sort of would wonder, was he ever falling asleep? Because he would sit by the entry to this very large room, and you couldn't see him. I
kind of in a shadow.
He was sort of in the shadow, and you didn't hear anything, so you'd sort of finish a movement, and you kind of wonder, you know. At one point, I did ask him, hello? And he was expecting me to go on, but I thought maybe you'd fallen asleep. I wasn't sure. He said, no. Go on, you know.
And he was often coming back from a two-week tour of Italy late the night before, so you had thought, I could understand if he would fall asleep after that.
And the weird thing was, if you played really well, he had almost nothing to say, and it was a little disappointing. You wanted to hear more about, how can I make it better, but he really, he was pretty true to form that way. You know, next, what, yeah. You know, you just worked super hard on the Chromatic Fantasy and Fugue, for example, to give your best presentation, and you know, in my case, he really liked it. And he said, next. And I thought, I figured we'd probably spend 20 minutes trying to, you know, including the playing at the least. And there it was. So you really always had to have a few things in your back pocket ready to just pull out on a moment's notice.
Boy, that sounds really daunting to always have not only just one recital, but a second one ready just in case.
Yeah.
You mentioned a little bit the experience of hearing him live, and there's some videos floating about where, as you know, he's quite immobile, and but getting just probably the most, I'm sure, beautiful sound. Harpsichords don't, unfortunately, carry so well in recordings. But that said, now that we are only more or less left with recordings, are there any that you recommend that are essential listening for everyone?
I think purple jacketed Froberger.
Unfortunately, my favorite ones are LPs, which there was he was the first to really record the pieces by Johann Jakob Froberger, because it was so enigmatic, that music, and yet he completely understood it and understood the gestures and the colors in it. And so I remember listening to that recording over and over. Any of his recordings of Bach, and one of my favorites was an LP called Festkonzert des Baroque, which had the A minor triple concerto, I believe, with probably Franz Bruggen playing, it's for flute.
Was his wife? I know his wife played with him.
Anyway, I believe his wife was playing it, and it was, if you have heard that piece, it is just an incredible work, and especially the slow movement was just so tender and moving, and that was one of my favorite recordings. Mm-hmm. And I have the LP and I still have a record player, I enjoy it still, and mm-hmm. haven't checked to see if it's still available, but I imagine it is. Mm-hmm. And so it was the Leonhardt consort playing that work. Mm-hmm. But yes, the Chromatic Fantasy, his...
Which I think he recorded three times. Mm-hmm. You know, because he didn't play it the same way 20 years later, so it was time to do a fresh recording.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So,
lovely.
I have to say, too, that at the time, and I'm sure this is still the case, at the time when we were studying with him in Amsterdam, there was just a revival in general of early music for ensembles, for choirs, for
harpsichord building.
And there was a lot of harpsichord building going on, and so there were constant concerts to attend in Amsterdam. Some in very intimate spaces, some in large churches, and especially organ concerts, which Leonhardt, he was the organist at the Oude Kerk, the old church, and so one could hear him play on Sunday mornings when he was there, or hear him play concerts. And so it was just such a wonderful, ripe environment. And there were a lot of other students, especially in Den Haag, in The Hague, studying at the conservatory there, other instrumentalists, viola da gamba, baroque flute, baroque violin. So it was that was part of the experience, too, was just being able to play with and hear other instruments and learning more about the harpsichord and about articulation and phrasing from hearing these wonderful, wonderful players.
And I think even though he was an incredibly sort of dignified, reserved man, he nonetheless, I remember going to one of those concerts, he hadn't told me about it, but he saw me, he was like, "Oh, you've come, how nice of you." As if, you know, why shouldn't I? You know? And he was just so excited that somebody cared enough to come and, you know, hear him play organ, which I hadn't heard.
Yeah. But perhaps to end, or almost end, I want to tell a funny story about him, because he was seen as being so somber and serious. And many of the photographs you see of him, he looks like he's almost grieving. He's so serious. And yet, I forget where this was. I think it might have been somewhere in Ohio, where he came to play, I believe, an organ recital. And so the organist and some friends took him out to dinner. And as they were going back to the church before the recital, he saw that there was a little fair going on. And he said, "Do we have perhaps 10 or 15 moments?" And I said, "Sure." And he walked over and bought a ticket and immediately got onto the bumper car rides. And in his suit and probably his scarf, he drove a bumper car around for 5 or 10 minutes. And, you know, came up, "Thank you. Let's go to the recital now, you know."
"I think I'm ready."
So there was certainly a very playful side to him that didn't show up very often except in, you know, I think through the music that was playful and joyful. So that was there.
Well, that's lovely. Do we have time for maybe one or two questions from the audience?
Sure. Yeah.
Greene's organ to it, and the way he played it was did sound organic, like it was like an organ, and how difficult that must be to create on the harpsichord.
You know, you mean the Bach prelude? Oh, yes. So in what ways did it sound organ-like to you?
When I think organ music versus harpsichord music, organ is sort of, everything kind of swooshes together, whereas harpsichord, everything separately. It's the complete 180 degrees opposite, yet the same piece, you can imagine hearing it in your head.
Oh, yes. I think one could play that piece on the organ quite successfully, and the fugue as well.
Bach certainly.
I do too, but I'm biased. So, but yeah, good point. There are many pieces. In fact, some of the toccatas, it's thought, could have been played. Those were not published as a group of toccatas. They appeared separately, and some of them could actually have been intended to be played on the organ.
But I think that early music in general has so many pieces were not as more modern music written for a particular instrument.
Right.
And when I studied early music, one of the things that one of my friends from her master's thesis did a Renaissance piece, mm-hmm. but there were a number of recordings. One was with a recorder quartet. It's horrible. Mm-hmm. One was with a mixed with singers. One was mm-hmm. with another. And mm-hmm. we did a mixed a piece with like a guitar, cello, and a bass recorder.
Uh-huh.
And uh-huh. having to hear the same music played in all those different ways, it was just.
It's enlightening.
It was just epiphany to hear the same music
yes.
played in all different ways. Which
yeah.
modern music, or even 19th century on, is just doesn't have that.
It doesn't happen as much. Yeah.
Specified.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's a good point. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
To be much more creative.
Yes. Yes. Thank you.
Well, nobody tries. I hadn't thought of this. Thank you, Elise, for that. To imitate the harpsichord on their instrument. That's a really
Why
funny concept.
That?
Yeah, imitate. No one say, oh, well, that's my divine purpose here at this moment, is to imitate the sound of a harpsichord.
That's true.
but the harpsichord, on the other hand, I mean, Alan was always talking about, you know, we're an imitation of the singer primarily and any other instrument. Here, this sounds bassoon-like and whatever. Mm-hmm. So we got a chance to try to give the impression mm-hmm. of lots of other instruments.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any one more question?
Anyone else?
Yeah.
I never met Leonhardt, but looking at kind of his output as a teacher, right, and taking into account one particular aspect, which is, you know, quietness of movement, as Jillon alluded to the puppet master. I think.
Mm-hmm.
The variety of approaches that Leonhardt's direct students had, you know, you get the whole gamut from, let's say, my teacher, Dada Maroney, who, mm-hmm. like, you can't see anything move. Like, it's amazing that anything comes out of the instrument at all. All the way to the other end of the spectrum, which is Toccata, which is
Right.
And the question that was there an orthodoxy that Leonhardt tried to instill? Were there absolute must-dos or absolute don't-dos that he transmitted?
Good question. I'm going to repeat it because since you don't have microphones, it'd be good to have the question repeated. So was there an orthodoxy that Leonhardt espoused, that things he insisted on, whether, you know, because he had students playing in so many different styles. And my sense, he never talked about technique. I don't think I remember him saying maybe talking about, you know, sort of slight rolls of the hand, but he kind of expected his students to have the technique to do what he was suggesting musically from day one. Was that your experience?
I remember asking him, I said, you never speak about technique. Oh, well, I know young people have to get technique. I don't know where they get it.
I don't want to what?
I don't know where they get it.
Oh, I don't know where they get it. That young people, okay, I'll repeat it. That young people get technique, but I don't know where. yeah. Did he speak to you, Elaine, about technique?
Not about technique, but I think of the orthodoxy. It really was in this nebulous form of, it had to be of good taste. and mm-hmm. you know, that was up to the ears of the receivers mm-hmm. to determine. But mm-hmm. he had a sense, if it wasn't good taste, he was not interested. And that was, if there was one black and white issue, I think that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And how do you define good taste? You know, and that was part of what we went there to learn. And it wasn't just good taste in music, but it was good taste in how to decorate your home. And
yeah, I think that's so true. And that's maybe a good place to end with that sense of good taste. That's what he was about.
And to dedicate this to him. This class, this has been a joy, and to thank the people of the Pedagogic Archive of Leonhardt who've worked so hard to put together things, because they know that when people who are part of these early waves die, when we pass on, that's, you know, we've lost the living energy that was still there. So yeah. Thank you, and thank you, Derek, for coming.
Oh, my pleasure. It was such a great. Again, let's thank you so much for your wonderful teaching and sharing today,
you're very
and for all the wonderful players again.
Thank you, Derek, players.
I have one question for Elaine. Are there links to these?
Yes.
I know we were hoping to put them in the program, but didn't quite get there. But
Facebook has a site. You can find that pretty easily. And if you, I think through Facebook, you might find that amazing interview of him, which then results in his sitting down and playing this allemande and talking about it and spending 10 minutes on half the bar of an allemande.
Yeah.
And
it's called the Raise
a Right. Right,
thank you.
Okay. It's amazing. Okay. If you have any trouble finding any of this, most of you know me and know my email, just contact me. I'd be happy to share it with you. And you, there's also some really interesting, Skip Sempe did quite a round of...
Did we bring the book?
I have a book. I don't have extras, but on the little red harpsichord.
Yeah, you can probably find it online. It's called The Little Red Harpsichord, and it's just a tiny book about Gustav Leonhardt and Skip Sempe's studying with him. So
yeah, he was one of our colleagues then.
Yep.
There. So
thank you.
Thank you for